Penguin Random House Audio presents Blue Horses, Poems by Mary Oliver. Read for you by Kimberly Farr. For Anne Taylor. If you don't break your ropes while you're alive, do you think ghosts will do it after? Kabir. After reading Lucretius, I go to the pond. The slippery green frog that went to his death in the heron's pink throat was my small brother. And the heron, with the white plumes like a crown on his head, who is washing now his great sword beak in the shining pond, is my tall, thin brother. My heart dresses in black and dances. What I can do. The television has two instruments that control it. I get confused. The washer asks me, "Do you want regular or delicate?" Honestly, I just want clean. Everything is like that. I won't even mention cell phones. I can turn on the light of the lamp beside my chair where a book is waiting, but that's about it. Oh yes, and I can strike a match and make fire. RUMI, for Coleman Barks. When RUMI went into the tavern, I followed. I heard a lot of crazy talk and a lot of wise talk, but the roses wouldn't grow in my hair. When RUMI left the tavern, I followed. I don't mean just to peek at such a famous fellow. Indeed, he was rather ridiculous, with his long beard and his dusty feet. But I heard less of the crazy talk and a lot more of the wise talk, and I was hopeful enough to keep listening until the day I found myself transformed into an entire garden of roses. First yoga lesson. Be a lotus in the pond, she said, opening slowly, no single energy tugging against another, but peacefully, all together. I couldn't even touch my toes. Feel your quadriceps stretching? She asked. Well, something was certainly stretching. Standing impressively upright, she raised one leg and placed it against the other, then lifted her arms and shook her hands like leaves. Be a tree, she said. I lay on the floor, exhausted. But to be a lotus in the pond, opening slowly and very slowly, rising, that I could do. I don't want to be demure or respectable. I don't want to be demure or respectable. I was that way, asleep, for years. That way you forget too many important things. How the little stones, even if you can't hear them, are singing. How the river can't wait to get to the ocean and the sky. It's been there before. What traveling is that? It is a joy to imagine such distances. I could skip sleep for the next 100 years. There is a fire in the lashes of my eyes. It doesn't matter where I am. It could be a small room. The glimmer of gold Burma saw on the kitchen pot was missed by everyone else in the house. Maybe the fire in my lashes is a reflection of that. Why do I have so many thoughts? They are driving me crazy. Why am I always going anywhere instead of somewhere? Listen to me or not, it hardly matters. I'm not trying to be wise. That would be foolish. I'm just chattering. Stebbin's Gulch. By the randomness of the way the rocks tumbled ages ago, the water pours. It pours. It pours ever along the slant of downgrade, dashing its silver thumbs against the rocks, or pausing to carve a sudden curled space where the flashing fish splash or drowse, while the kingfisher overhead rattles and stares. And so it continues for miles, this bolt of light, its only industry to descend and to be beautiful while it does so. As for purpose, there is none. It is simply one of those gorgeous things that was made to do what it does perfectly and to last, as almost nothing does, almost forever. No matter what. No matter what the world claims, its wisdom always growing, so it said. Some things don't alter with time. The first kiss is a good example, and the flighty sweetness of rhyme. No matter what the world preaches, spring unfolds in its appointed time. The violets open and the roses. Snow in its hour builds its shining curves. There's the laughter of children at play and the wholesome sweetness of rhyme. No matter what the world does, some things don't alter with time. The first kiss, the first death, the sorrowful sweetness of rhyme. Angels. You might see an angel any time and anywhere. Of course, you have to open your eyes to a kind of second level, but it's not really hard. The whole business of what's reality and what isn't has never been solved and probably never will be. So I don't care to be too definite about anything. I have a lot of edges called perhaps, and almost nothing you can call certainty. For myself, but not for other people. That's a place you just can't get into, not entirely, anyway, other people's heads. I'll just leave you with this. I don't care how many angels can dance on the head of a pin. It's enough to know that for some people, they exist, and that they dance. What we want. In a poem, people want something fancy, but even more, they want something inexplicable, made plain, easy to swallow. Not unlike a suddenly harmonic passage in an otherwise difficult and sometimes dissonant symphony, even if it is only for the moment of hearing it. If I wanted a boat, I would want a boat, if I wanted a boat, that bounded hard on the waves, that didn't know starboard from port and wouldn't learn, that welcomed dolphins and headed straight for the whales, that, when rocks were close, would slide in for a touch or two, that wouldn't keep land in sight and went fast, that leaped into the spray. What kind of life is it always to plan and do?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.